If you're new to grossing, I'm going to teach you how to describe any specimen you receive in the lab, essentially becoming the eyes of a pathologist or any physician who reads your report. If you're new here, my name is Luke. I'm a pathologist assistant working in Canada, and I'm looking to share what I've learned over the past few years with new PAs and working PAs alike. So as a PA, it's your job to describe specimens that come into the lab, and it's the pathologist's job to give a diagnosis. In terms of what you can say, your descriptions should really be painting a picture of what you're seeing as if the pathologist was there themselves. You're looking to avoid using diagnostic terminology, but otherwise it's pretty open in terms of what you can say. Broadly speaking, there are two main things to worry about describing: the specimen ID or specimen identifiers and the pathology. All right, so starting off with the specimen ID or identifiers. Now, in every single case, regardless of whether it's a small biopsy or a large complex resection, you're always going to start with the same thing, which is the patient identifiers. This is the name of the patient and typically the accession number that's also included with the case. Then from there, you're going to describe whether or not the tissue was received fresh or in formalin or a different kind of fixative. And then you are looking to move on to what is actually included in the entire specimen. So again, sometimes it's just a tiny biopsy, which is just a small fragment of tissue, but other times you can be receiving a piece of an organ, a slice of an organ, or an entire organ itself. So for example, for a breast resection, you could get the entire breast. You could just be getting a lumpectomy or a segmental resection. So it's important to know what actually was received in the lab. For more complex resections, you may receive multiple organs together. So those each need to be described on their own, and just so the pathologist knows what was actually received in the lab. And then from there, if there was any orientation provided for the tissue itself, typically sutures, staples, or clips, which might give like a superior and a lateral, include that in your description here as well. The next thing that you are going to describe is just the size of the tissue. Generally speaking, you can include some qualitative and quantitative measures of size. Quantitative would be things like the actual measurements. So if it's, you know, 10 centimeters by 8 centimeters by 8 centimeters, include that as well as the weight. And then if the tissue itself appears enlarged or shrunken, those are good things to mention too, because sometimes there's hypertrophic or atrophic processes going on that may actually affect the visual appearance of the tissue. From there, you can describe the shape of the tissue. A lot of things that appear normal can generally just be remarked as unremarkable, but if there is a, you know, perhaps bulging area or area that is distorted on the tissue, like in a fibroid uterus, it's good to include those here. Other things that you might be concerned about mentioning for the shape are maybe areas of puckering or angulation. Often these can be things that are caused by some kind of inflammatory process or by a malignancy. Then the next thing is going to be the color. Now, for the most part, tissue is either kind of a light tan or a gray, depending on whether it's fresh or fixed. There are sort of some exceptions to this, but for the most part, it should look like that. If there is some kind of greenish discoloration or black, that might be some kind of mummification or a necrotic process going on. If there is some kind of white, you know, white discoloration, that could easily be fibrin, or perhaps that's tumor involving a serosal surface. And then deep reds or purples, things like that, are often hemorrhagic or congested. So these are things that you want to note in your description as well. And then lastly, it's a good idea to comment on the outer surface itself. So the vast majority of tissues within your body are designed to slide against each other, kind of like this. So they should be generally smooth and glistening. Now, if there is any kind of roughened area on that outer surface, that can be from a couple different things. Generally, if a surgeon has cut through something, that is going to create a roughened surface, and that's typically a actual margin. But other things that can cause that roughened adhesion could be some kind of inflammatory process or malignancy on the surface of a tissue, or even some previous surgery. Those often lead to more adhesions and roughened areas on tissues. So those are things that you want to be looking out for. As well, if the tissue is intact or non-intact, that's a good idea to include that here. And then also the actual texture or consistency of the tissue. So normal tissue is like the three bears. It's not too hot, not too cold. It's just sort of right in the middle of it in terms of softness. But if the tissue is really soft, that can be indicative of some kind of necrotic process going on. If the tissue is on the other side of the spectrum, really firm, that could be perhaps indication of malignancy. And if the tissue is really hard itself, there can be calcification going on there too. So those are all great things to make note of. Now, secondly is the pathology. And if it's present, you must describe it. That's typically the reason why the tissue was removed. Now, sometimes there isn't pathology in that specific specimen. Maybe it's a completion surgery and the other specimens that came with the case had the main pathology in them, and this is just the completion. Or sometimes the surgeon is actually missed and they might have to go back to actually resect whatever they're initially concerned with. So definitely make note of that. Things you might be seeing here are inflamed or infarcted areas. These can have generally kind of a more hemorrhagic, a darker red or purple appearance. Or there can be evidence of malignancy. These can be large masses involving one or more tissues or organs. And in each of these cases, it is going to be most important typically to describe the size of that area of pathology. So you can give two or three dimensions where applicable here, and then the extent of involvement of that pathology in the tissue itself and its relationship to anatomical landmarks. So typically these are the surgical margins, how close it's coming to whatever margins are present, and then if it's involving more than just the primary area that was excised. Now, typically some important things to make note of, especially in cases of malignancy, is the size can often have staging implications, or the actual depth of invasion can have staging implications. Now, if you don't know what these are off by heart for every different type of tissue, that's okay. There are protocols online that you can look up through CAP, and these are usually broken down by organ system. So I would definitely recommend checking those out if you need a guideline on focusing on what is most important. And in terms of descriptive words you might be looking for when you're actually describing lesions or areas of pathology, generally if you are focusing on whether there is one sort of like a focal lesion, or if there are multiple lesions or lesions covering a diffuse area, those are good terms to include. But if you're really hurting for kind of what words to work with, that's okay. When I first started out, I didn't have a huge library running through my head. Some resources that I used were this Gross Pathology Handbook. It has a bunch of great examples of pictures and different lesions that those pictures are actually describing. So I used that to kind of sprinkle in some terms to better describe areas of pathology that I was seeing. Also, the Lusters and Westrett Surgical Handbooks are also good resources to go to just double check and make sure that you're describing relevant areas of the tissue, and they might include some other terms that would be good to focus on and use in your descriptions. One other thing to keep in mind is when you are describing, especially these areas of pathology, we want to try and avoid using diagnostic terms. We're trying to stick to basically what you can just see with your eyes, and then the pathologist will form a diagnosis based on that. However, there are certain times where a diagnostic term might be a lot more efficient to use. So for example, if you have a diverticulum in a bowel, you might just say diverticulum versus a mucosal outpouching of the intestinal wall into pericolic fat. Those are both really the same thing, and your pathologist might be okay with that more efficient use just of diverticulum, but I would avoid using a lot of terms like that unless you've checked with them first or gotten kind of the okay from them to use those types of terms. So using some of those tips, I think it would be appropriate for you to try even practice describing some things that you could find at home. For example, this here I would describe as a cylindrical object with a thick white outer layer that is soft, with a inner tubular structure that is brown and firm. On the outer surface, there is a focal or singular area of black pigmentation that is poorly circumscribed and measures 3 by 2 by 0.2 centimeters. And it comes to within 6 centimeters of each of the margins, which are the ends of the cylindrical object. Congratulations, you've described a roll of toilet paper. And you could do the same thing with something as simple as this, an orange round ovoid object, which is soft with a speckled or pebbled outer surface. On sectioning, the cut surface has a thin rim of the orange outer surface, enclosing a soft orange central area that is divided into triangular regions with thin fibrous septae. In the center, there is a firmer white pulpy area. So you can use some of those terms and those strategies to actually start describing pathology that you would see in tissues and organs. And keep in mind, it doesn't have to be overly complicated. At the end of the day, you are just saying what you are seeing. So it doesn't have to use a lot of extraneous flowery language. Just imagine if you couldn't see the specimen, what would give you a good picture of it as if you were there without looking at it? Like many other skills, grossing and describing pathology specimens requires more than reading manuals and watching videos like these. You'll need some hands-on practice sooner or later. But once you feel like you've gotten a handle on it, come back and check out this other video, which will show you how to format your gross. I think it'll help you make things more readable and more presentable for the pathologist that reads your cases. Thanks for tuning in. I'll catch you next time.